God is good. Amen. Woo! Y'all wouldn't call me Pentecostal if I had a shouting fit up here or something, would you? Well, be honest, you would, wouldn't you? All right. If you have your Bible this morning, we'll skip that. Let's turn to Colossians chapter number 1. Colossians chapter number 1, and let's begin in verse number 15. Colossians chapter 1, verse number 15. If you're physically able, I'm going to ask you to stand back up again. We try to keep you awake, you know. We keep you going up and down. That way you'll stay awake while I preach. Colossians chapter 1, beginning in number 15. The verse says, "Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created, that are in heavens, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist." Let's pray. Father, we thank you today, God, that you are in charge. Lord, we thank you that you govern the affairs of man. We thank you, Lord, that you loved us enough to send your Son to die for us. Lord, as we look at your preeminence today in creation, we pray, God, that you would just infiltrate our hearts with the light of truth that we need to govern who we are in the dark world we live in. Father, we know that you love us, and we know that you want to save us all. Father, help us be a part of that plan of salvation this very day. Lord, if we're lost today, if one is here who doesn't know you as Savior, may they receive the hope of the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ and be saved today. Father, if there are those here today who are saved but following you with guilt in their life and shame as a result of sin, may you draw them to yourself through that great act of repentance, through your love and mercy and your goodness. God, if there are those here today, Lord, who are apathetic to the things of the kingdom of God, may you set a fire under them. And God, may they see your holiness and the need to react to that today in their own life to win others to Christ. God, may you be glorified in this place, in our lives. May your children be edified. God, thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please take your seat. The title of the message is Christ Preeminent in Creation, which is what we talked about last week a little bit, Paul's Tiller Training Part 2. And we looked, first of all, going through the book of Colossians. We're doing a series verse by verse through the entire book. And we have already looked at the church at Colossae. We said they are members of the family of God. They're cherished members of the family of God, and that they are really working members of the family of God, or productive members of the family of God. And then we said that Paul set out to pray for them, a prayer request that could be prayed for any church and should be prayed for ours here at Parkview, that they would know God's will, that we would know God's will, that we would experience God's power, and that we would receive God's blessing. And it's important that we understand that today. And then last week, we went a little bit further, and we began to talk about Christ and how preeminent he is in salvation. Christ on the cross. And we read really only two verses. We talked about 13 and 14, that he had delivered us from the power of darkness, that he had translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sin. And that was really the gist of it, that we understand that he was, is, will always be preeminent on the cross and preeminent in our salvation, and he meets the need of mankind. Now today, we want to talk about Christ preeminent in creation. And we understand that what Paul was trying to do, like I said, in how we trained the old teller, was we gave him real money. And they went through real money, and they felt real money, and they counted real money, and they smelled real money, and they touched real money, and they saw it over and over and over again. That way, when something false showed up, they could tell that it was fake, that it was false. And that's really what Paul's mindset is here as he speaks to the church at Colossae, as those who are following him trying to bring in false religion, Gnosticism, legalism, Judaism, all back to the churches. And Paul is trying to warn them, hey, to keep your eyes open that you are complete in Christ, that you are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, and nothing else is going to get you to heaven. And that's really what he's telling them. He's overexposing them a hair to the love of Jesus Christ, to the excellency of Jesus Christ, to the reality of Jesus Christ. So as we look at this passage today, we see really who Christ is, not only on Calvary's cross for salvation, but also who he is in creation and really sustainability for all mankind. And we begin in verse number 15 with the person he reveals and the position he holds. In verse number 15, the Bible says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. Now, he's talking about who is, that being the subject, being Jesus Christ. He said, so Christ is that image. And the word image is the word that we use for icon today. We know about that. You computer enthusiasts use the word icon. And how many of you here use computers one way or another? Personal computer, whatever. Okay, how many of you have ever used Microsoft Word? All right? Okay, we're on a roll now. How many of you wouldn't raise your hand if Jesus Christ told you to? No, I'm just kidding. So we see on our computers that we have a little W. And that little W is an icon. It's an icon for the computer program Microsoft Word. And really what it is that program on our computer. And when we click that program, guess what happens? Woo! Microsoft Word opens up to us. And we're able to use every reality of that computer program if we know how. If we've been schooled, if we've learned, if we studied, right? We can use every aspect of that program. Well, what Paul is telling the folks that if they click on Jesus, they see God. They click on Jesus, they see God. So the image of the invisible God gives additional thought suggested by that word invisible, that Christ is the visible representation of the full manifestation of God to all created beings. That the exact likeness of God is expressed in a manifestation of Jesus Christ, involved in the essential relationship of the Godhead, and therefore unique and perfect. In fact, John described it like this. Are you ready? Deep theological truth here. John 14:9. He says, he who hath seen me hath seen the Father. Amen? So that's what he's saying here, that icon is there. It's there for us. So now listen, when we as human beings, as we begin to think about certain words like eternal and invisible, our mind begins to shrink a bit, if we're honest with ourselves. Because we can't hardly relate to something that's invisible or something that's eternal. You see, because we can't measure that in our human existence. But that's who Jesus is. He is a picture of the invisible God. We can't see God. We look for God. We feel for God all through the Old Testament. Now, he showed up occasionally in Christophanies and things like that. But mostly he did not reveal himself to mankind as Jesus did. So when we look at this, we understand that Jesus, J.B. Phillips said it like this. He said, Jesus is God in focus, okay? If you've ever tried to focus a camera or a pair of binoculars or a cheap rifle scope, you know what I'm talking about, right? You got a big buck out there in front of you, and you're trying to get him in there. You just can't zero that scope enough. He's fuzzy, and you can't tell whether it's a buck or a doe and whether he's legal or not. And you're twisting on that scope. But listen, you don't have to twist on God's scope. All you got to do is look at Jesus. And you look at Jesus, and guess what you see? you see God in focus. And that's really what he was saying. So he is the image of the invisible God, the mirror, the icon. He possesses the divine attributes of God. Now, we know that because John 1:14, now think about this for a minute. John 1:14 says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." So, the Word, being the title that Jesus used, or John used to describe Jesus, the Word, the Logos, was made flesh. In other words, God took on human flesh. And he came to this earth and he dwelled among us. He tabernacled. He built a tent among us. He dwelled in our presence. And we beheld his glory. We saw his magnificent, radiant beauty is what he's talking about. Now, he also says that that was the same glory of the only begotten of the Father, that was God's glory that you saw shining through the flesh of Jesus Christ as he accomplished the will of God the Father here on earth. So, he was full of grace and truth. Amen. He is the only standard for truth that exists in the universe. All right, so you got that. You with me? Say amen. Amen. All right. Now, Hebrews 1:1 says this, and following says this, says, "God, who at sundry times, in divers manners, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, by who being the brightness of his glory," the same thing again, "the brightness of his glory, and the express image," a word again, the same that we saw previously, "of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, set down at the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they." You see, what are we saying? Well, we're saying Jesus is flawless, moment by moment, audiovisual, three-dimensional, a demonstration of who God is. That's what we're saying about Jesus Christ. You see, Christ is all God is in every aspect, in every facet. So he is visible, he's audible, he's approachable, he's knowledgeable, he's available, he's knowable, right? Jesus is very God. He is the image of the invisible God. He is also the impressive firstborn of every creature. Now, understand, the person he reveals is God the Father. The position he holds is that he is the firstborn, the impressive firstborn of every creature. What are you saying, Brother Barry? I'm saying that he's self-existent, pre-existent, from eternity, separate from creation, supreme in position. And really, this speaks of his sovereignty and his deity, that this is who Jesus is. Now draw back a minute and think. What is Paul trying to tell us? Paul is trying to tell us Jesus is all we need. He's trying to tell us that works won't get us there, finances won't get us there, good looks won't get us there, only Jesus will get us there. That's really what he's saying in the common vernacular. So the person he reveals is God, and the position he holds is that he is the impressive firstborn of every creature. He is superior and distinct from the entire sphere of yet created beings and things, and yet he preceded the creation of all that there is. You understand what I'm saying? These young folks, well, 10 years ago, they would say, he's the bomb diggity. Okay, now they don't use that terminology anymore because that's dated, right? They'd have another a wonderful phrase to use on that. I would almost use the word unbelievable if I didn't believe, but I do, you see, because he is so amazing, so awesome, another dated word, but he is so spectacular, and the Bible says he is the impressive firstborn of every creature. In John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and life was the light of men. You see, what is he saying? He's saying Jesus surpasses everything we know about time. Jesus surpasses everything we know about even eternity. Jesus was in the beginning. Now, I don't know about you, but that creates a little confusion in my finite mind. And probably yours too. God, who at sundry times in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophet, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom he made the worlds. In Psalm 89:27 it says this: also I will make my firstborn higher than the kings of the earth. Now, what is the application to that, Brother Barry? You told us here that he is the image of the invisible God, that he is the impressive firstborn of every creature. But I'm going to tell you, he's also the one and only of one kind. And that's really what the word begotten means. He is the one and only of one kind. In other words, there's only one. There is not another. There will never be another. There will never exist another. He's the only one. When Jesus came to earth and was robed in flesh, God broke the mold. That was it. There'll never be another one like him. And that's what we get when we see in John 1:14, where he says that he was robed in flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, that of the only begotten of the Father. That's what he's saying in the word begotten. That's what it says in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that whosoever believed in him should not perish but have everlasting life, right? That he sent his only begotten Son to die for us, right? His only begotten, the one and only of one kind. There will never be another. There is no other. There's no other way to heaven. There's no other way to get there. So what are we saying, Brother Barry? Well, what we're saying is we need to get a grip on Jesus, you see, because Jesus is God. Now, that's what makes us different as Christians from Mormons what's that other bunch? Jehovah's Witnesses, that's right. That's what makes us different from all those cults out there. And that's what I call them. I call them cults because that's what they are. They're not Christian oriented. They're a cult, and they don't have the basis of Christ, the Christ of the Bible. The 1961 translation of the New World Translation of Jehovah's Witnesses, 1961, says, "In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was a God." No, the Word was not a God. The Word is, was, and will always be very God. He is the only God. In fact, I'll go a little bit further than that. He is the image of the invisible God and the firstborn of every creature. He is the image of God. He's the icon of God. He's the expression of God. No, my friends, he is God. He is very God. So, who does he reveal? He reveals God the Father. What position does he hold? Well, he holds that position of the firstborn of every creature and the impression of the one and only of any one that will ever come about. So, Brother Barry, what's the application? Hate the sin, love the sinner. How do you like that? Hate the sin, love the sinner. So what are you saying? I'm saying that Paul is telling the people that they have to know Jesus. And if they know Jesus, they know God. And when they know God, they'll love what God loves. And the Bible says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So you'll love what God loves, you'll hate what God hates, you'll do what God does, you'll be accessible to what Jesus was accessible to. And as a child of God, you will serve God with an obedient and a willful heart, in submission, knowing that he is the supreme authority of the universe. And that is the person of Jesus Christ we see, who Paul is trying to tell the people about, that he is preeminent in creation. Now, not only do we see the person he reveals in the position he holds, just lay that aside, but next we see the power he possesses and the purpose he wields. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. So let's try to dissect that. First of all, he created all things everywhere intelligible. You see, any being beyond the scope of science, which is wholly concerned with how things go on with no proof of how anything really began, is in its rawest form, especially concerning the material universe. You say, what did you just say, Brother Barry? I'm saying that science doesn't say anything about creation. Science only lets you know what's going on now. Maybe what they speculate has gone on in the past. But understand that for one scientist let's just ask this. When we talk about, you want to talk about evolution and everything, which scientist was there who observed the beginning? I can tell you who was. You ready? None. There was no scientist there who saw the beginning because he was in the beginning. He is the beginning, right? So a scientist, all a scientist can do really is guess about how things took place. In other words, he can look at something and he can say, well, because I've lived this long and he lived that long and they lived this long, I speculate this is really what happened. But you see, friend, that's not speculation. I mean, that's not fact, that's speculation. That is not fact, that's theory. Henceforth, evolution theory, right? Because none of them were there to see the beginning when it began. So they cannot attest to it as a fact. History only observes what is taking place now. They cannot say what happened in the beginning. So what are we saying? We're saying that we live in a world of theory aside from the Word of God. That the Word of God tells us the fact. And the fact of the matter is this. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. You see, God created the fact of the matter is this. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. You see, those are facts. But everything else is merely speculation about the Big Bang Theory and how this happened and how that happened. Name one of them who was there to see it. You can't. I'm going to tell you a little story. My daughter was enrolled at school at Liberty University, and we lived in Christiansburg about 80 or 90 miles away, and I think this was in 2000. And we were in our first pastorate, and she came down to take me to dinner on my birthday. And she had some coupons because she worked at Texas Roadhouse and she got a discount. And anyway, we went around there and we ate, right? It was right around from the house. So we came back, right? And she had to drive all the way back to Liberty University. And she was 17 years old. She was in college and she was driving her first car. And it started pouring down rain, just a downpour. I mean, the bucket just turned upside down, right? And my wife and I went home and our daughter took off on the road to go to back to Liberty University. And as she was going to Liberty University, my wife and I laid down and went to sleep. And all of a sudden, I woke up out of a dead sleep, and I looked at my wife, and I said, something's wrong. I said, I don't know what, but something's wrong. 2 minutes later, my daughter called, wailing, crying. She had wrecked her car, totaled on the highway on 460, as she turned into Liberty University. And she's, Dad, what do I do? What do I do? I said, well, there were police there. Yes, they're there. This, that. They gave her a ticket for reckless driving. And I went to court with her. And so we were in the courtroom, and they had given her this ticket for reckless driving. And what really made me mad was I kind of wanted to choke the police officer. Now, I'm not, you know, we're real about this, right? I mean, we're telling the truth here. So I really wanted to choke this guy because, number one, he didn't take her out of the rain and put her in his car. She was 17 years old, young female, out by herself at night in the dark. It was pouring down rain. He made her stand outside the car while he filled out the report. That was number one. So I was a little bit excited, if you could imagine that. I don't get excited like that anymore, or any less. But anyway, I was quite excited. But to make a long story short, I went to court with her, and the judge said, "Mary, stand up." And Mary stood up, and it was a female judge, and she said, "Come forward." And my Mary was a little bit hesitant about that. She got up, and I said, "Just tell the truth, Mary. Whatever happened." Just tell them, I'm here for you. I'll get you out of jail. So she got, or you get me out, one or the other. I didn't know which way it was going to go. But anyway, got her up front there, and Mary began to tell her story. And she said, I don't know what was happening. It was pouring down rain. It's the first time I'd been on this long a drive. And I turned off the exit ramp on the highway. I hit my brakes. The car started hydroplaning. And I spun like three times. And I hit the guardrail every time I went around. And She said, then the guy came and he made me stand out in the rain. And by this time, I'm starting to get red-faced already, and I don't know if the judge knows that or not. But anyway, he's got the police officer up there who wrote the report, and charged her with reckless driving and this and that. She looked at my daughter, and she said, well, were you driving recklessly? And she said, no, ma'am. She said, well, you're speeding. She said, no, ma'am. And she said, okay, have a seat. And she called the police officer's name, and he stood up there. She said, no, you come over here. She had him stand in front of her, and she said, how long was Mary there before you got there? He said, approximately 10 minutes. Okay. And did you let her get in the back seat of your car while you filled out the report? And he looked at me. I looked at him. I looked at the judge, and I'm like, how did she figure that out? But anyway, he said, no. She stood outside. I said, what was the climatic conditions? What was going on? I said, it was pouring down rain. He said, okay. And the judge looked him in the eye and said, let me ask you a question. The officer said, did you see Mary driving recklessly? Do you have proof that she was driving recklessly? He said, no, but you can tell how many times her car went around and what happened, that obviously she was driving too fast for road conditions, this and that, this and that. And she said, dismiss. Mary, you can leave. What caused her to make that decision was the fact that that officer was not there when the accident took place. He had no clue that she was driving recklessly or not, because he was not there in the beginning of that accident. He was there in the aftermath of that accident. But let me tell you, we serve a God, Jesus Christ, robed in flesh, dwelling among men, who was there in the beginning. And he will be the judge. He will be the judge, no matter what anybody else says. He will be the ultimate authority who dismisses any kind of case. So he created all things, everywhere, intelligent. Now, you say, Brother Barry, well, what makes the difference between speculation or theory and fact? Revelation. Revelation. Had the officer been there, he could have given a revelation to the judge that, hey, I saw what happened in this accident. He could not provide that revelation because he was not there. But let me tell you something. Jesus was there. Amen. And the Holy Spirit of the living God inspired, breathed upon the heart of not only John, but Paul as well, and various other New Testament writers to say that Jesus was in the beginning. You see, they have validated the fact that in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that, my friend, is factual, because the Bible is a reliable historical text in which we have breathed straight from God, written over 1,400 years, 40 authors, 3 continents, etc., etc. So the bottom line is this: Jesus is who he says he is, and he possesses great power. First of all, he created everything. He created things visible and invisible. So he created the sun. Whew, man, we know that this past week, right? A couple of weeks, maybe 3 weeks. Brad, was the sun out? You know why? Because God created the sun. And Brad and Randy been out there in it every day, out there working, slaving away. Some of you other folks, I understand. But the bottom line is God created the sun. Oh, yes. And by the way, when the windstorm blows up, the wind blows, right? How many of you ever really see the wind? Nobody. We see the effects of the wind, but we can't see the wind. But you know who created the wind? God created the wind. And he used the person of Jesus Christ to do it. So listen, he said, for by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created for him and by him. You see, he created everything, visible and invisible. He created offices of influence, world governments and governing angels, and he will stand in judgment of all of those. He created everything, and it was created by him and for him indisputably. You say, why were those things created? So that God, Jesus would be able to accomplish the will of the Father. That was ultimately why everything was created. Why were you and I created? We were created so that we could have fellowship, honor, and worship God. I mean, that's why we were created. that we could be in his presence. And the Bible says that God's name is jealous, that he's a jealous God. Therefore, he wants all of our worship, all of our praise, all of our glory, all of our honor. He wants it all. And he deserves it all. Why? Because he's the creator and sustainer of the entire universe. You see, Paul was telling the people, listen, not only is Christ preeminent on Calvary's cross, but the Word of God teaches us he was also preeminent in creation. Why? Because he reveals God the Father, and he holds the position of the firstborn of every creature, and he possesses great power, the power to create everything, and he really accomplishes the will of the Father. That's what it's all about. He created everything. He is all-powerful. We realize that, right? God is all-powerful. I want to turn over to Revelation, and hopefully I don't get too far off base, but they said I could preach till 2 o'clock. I don't know. Anyway, that was in the contract when I came. I'm just kidding. In Revelation chapter 4 and 5, first of all, in Revelation chapter 4, verse number 1, I believe we see the rapture of the church. He says, after this I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me and said, come up hither. I believe that's a rapture of the church, okay? And I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one was set upon the throne, and he that sat was to look upon like a jasper or a sardine stone, and there was a rainbow round about the throne in the sight like unto an emerald, and round about the throne there were 4 and 20 seats, and upon the seats I saw 4 and 20 elders sitting clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold, and out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunders and voices, and there were 7 lamps of a fire burning before the throne, which are 7 spirits of God. You can go to Isaiah 11:2, I think, see that? And therefore, the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne and round about the throne, there were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, the second like a calf, the third like the face of a man, and the fourth like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about them, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is and what and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 4 and 20 elders fall down before him and that sat on the throne and worship him and that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Thou hast created all things, and by thy pleasure they were and are created. Amen. And he said, and I saw in the right hand of him that sat upon the throne a book written within and without on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof. And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereupon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, weep not. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the 4 beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, and it as it had been slain, having 7 horns and 7 eyes, which are the 7 spirits of God sent forth upon all the earth. And he came and took the book out of my hand, and of him that sat upon the throne. And when he had taken the book, the 4 beasts and the 4 and 20 elders fell down before the lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and wast redeemed to God by the blood out of every kindred, every tongue, and every people, every nation, and hath made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth, and I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them, there were 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive the power and the riches and the wisdom and the strength and the honor and the glory and blessing." And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such are as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I say, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth on the throne, unto the Lamb forever and ever. And the four beasts said, "Amen." And the four and the 20 elders fell down and worship him that liveth forever and ever. Say, Brother Barry, what was that all about? Hey, it all goes back to, "Thou art worthy to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things." Listen, he has created all things. All things. Listen, that's why he's preeminent. That's why he's supreme. That's why we preach him today. That's why we come to church. That's why we come on the first day of the week, because we were commanded to. Listen, he possesses great power, and he purposes to do the will of God the Father. He reveals the person of God the Father, and he holds the position of the firstborn of every creature. You see, Christ is not only preeminent on Calvary's cross, but Christ is also preeminent in creation. That'd be a good place to say amen. Final point. Amen. The preeminence he displays and the peculiarity he mobilizes. And he is before all things. And by him all things consist. He is more important than anything else in the world. He's more important than your trip to Walmart. He's more important than your beans burning. He's more important than your personal preference. He's more important than anything. He is the top of the totem pole, and he holds the totem pole upright. He is the stuff. He is all there is. He is preeminent perfection. You know, he is preeminent perfection. I think about the miracles of God when I wrote that down. I thought about the first miracle that he performed. And he turned the water into wine. Now, we know, I'm not trying to raise up a bunch of winos in here, don't get me wrong, okay? But he turned that water into wine. And it was not just good wine. It was great wine, you know? In fact, they said, "Why have you saved this until last?" You see, Jesus is preeminent perfection. You see, when he healed the lame man, he jumped up. He began to leap. He began to praise Jesus. You see, he is preeminent perfection. He is greater than any other. He is in first place. He is above anything that we can ever begin to imagine or think. When the blind man was blind from birth, and Jesus called him to see, I'd say he said Jesus was a great God. When he healed a woman with the issue of blood, all those years, she'd been everywhere, spent every penny she had on doctors, tried her best to figure out what was going on. She just touched the hem of his garment. See, Jesus is preeminent perfection. He is permanent perfection. You know, when he cast out the demons, and they went into the hogs, and the hogs ran over the hill, the demons never came back to the man. Why? They were cast out permanently. I'm going to tell you something. That's what eternal life is all about. When Jesus saved your soul, when he paid the penalty on Calvary's cross, he did it once for all. And if you trusted him, you surrendered to him, you have eternal life. And I don't care what you put in the name of your church. Listen. If you don't have eternal life, you don't have life. Amen? Listen, you don't have life. And I don't care what you call the church. Listen, you either are or you ain't. You either saved or you ain't. There ain't no halfway house, and you ain't losing if you got it. Amen? So listen, that's what eternal is all about. Eternal is, I trusted Christ for eternal life. That doesn't mean I'm going to say a bad word and lose my salvation. That doesn't mean I'm going to sin and come short of the glory of God, and all of a sudden he's going to yank the eternal carpet out from under my feet. No, if you have eternal life, you have eternal life, and eternal life exists from a moment you trust Christ through eternity, and there is no end. You see, what are you saying, Brother Barry? I'm saying that he is preeminent, and listen, and he displays a peculiarity that you can't find anywhere else. Listen, his preeminence is perfection. His preeminence is always permanent. Last but not least, his perfection is perpetual. It's perpetual. Say, Brother Barry, what do you mean by perpetual? I mean, it just keeps going and going and going through all eternity. You know, even during Revelation, people will be saved. Now, I hate to, during the tribulation, I hate to see that. I hate for anybody to have to wait that long or try to wait that long, because they may not make it. They may be killed instead. But you know, eternity is based on perfection. Eternity is based on perfection. You realize that, right? I mean, the Bible says when we get there, there'll be no sin. There'll be no sickness. There'll be no pain. There'll be no sadness other than the time when he wipes away the tears from our eyes. Listen, his perfection is perpetual. It goes on forever. I'd like to read you a few facts, and maybe you can understand better who I'm talking about here. I'm telling you that the person he reveals is God, and he holds a position of the firstborn of every creature. I'm telling you that he possesses great power and purposes God's will. I'm trying to tell you that his preeminence is always on display. You see, the earth 7,927 miles in diameter at the earth, at the equator. Our sun is the nearest star. It's 865,400 miles in diameter. If the sun had a hole in it, you could put 1,200,000 Earths in it and have room for 4,300,000 of our moons to go inside. The star Antares could hold 64 million suns the size of ours. And there's a star in the constellation Hercules that could contain 100 million stars the size of Antares. The earth circles the sun at an average distance of 93 million miles and at a speed of 67,000 miles per hour. The earth's surface encompasses 196,949,970 square miles. The star Betelgeuse is 880 quadrillion miles away. If the molecule of a single drop of water could be converted into grains of sand, there would be enough sand to build a concrete highway half a mile wide and 1 foot thick, all the way from New York to San Francisco. The Milky Way has 200 billion stars banded together by what science calls gravity, and our galaxy is only one of billions in the universe. He created the hummingbird and the sperm whale on the same day. He knows your name. The hairs on your head are numbered. He knows what you had for breakfast this morning. And he loved you enough to die for you. Jesus Christ is preeminent in creation. Jesus Christ is preeminent on Calvary's cross. And Jesus Christ's greatest desire is to be preeminent in your life. In your life. He wants you to be preeminent in your life. He wants you to turn loose of your will and trust him with the affairs of your life. God loved you enough to die for you. He sent his son, Jesus. He came to earth robed in flesh, and he was treated horribly. He died a death that no one deserves to die. He was hung on a cross between heaven and earth by the religious political leaders of the day. They crucified him. They beat him, they spat upon him, They plucked out his beard. They stripped him naked before his own mama standing at the foot of the cross. They drove nails in his hands and his feet. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. They pierced his side with a spear. And he cried out from Calvary's cross, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do." Christ is preeminent. Week after next, we'll look at one more step of preeminence in Christ's life. Not only is he preeminent on the cross, not only is he preeminent in creation, but he is preeminent in his church. But he wants preeminence in your heart, in your life, in your activities. I'd ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads. You can be complete in Christ if you're not already. Today, if you're here and you've never trusted Christ as your personal Savior, sometimes we'll make it so hard. But the Bible says simply believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and that God raised Jesus from the dead and you shall be saved. He says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There are none righteous, no, not one. None of us deserve to go to heaven. None of us are good enough. None of us are rich enough. None of us are smart enough. But God loved us enough to send his Son to die on Calvary's cross that we could have the forgiveness of sins. If you've never surrendered to him, today's that day. You just say a simple prayer, something like this. Mean it from your heart to God's heart. Say, God, I know I've sinned, and I've come short of your glory. God, I believe what the Bible says about Jesus. Jesus, I believe you came to this earth to die for my sin. Would you please forgive me? Would you come into my heart, save my soul, forgive my sin? Help me live for you. I surrender today. I throw up the white flag, God. Please, I surrender. Come into my heart. The Bible says, I believe if you prayed a prayer or something like that and you meant it from your heart, you've been born again. You've trusted Christ as your personal Savior. Now, you have to confess him before man. We'll give you that opportunity in a moment. As we sing a song, if you've trusted Christ today and you've never told anybody, you never stood publicly and said, I just want to profess Christ as my Savior today, you can do that. If you're here today, and you say, Brother Barry, I believe everything you said. I believe the Bible. But I'm just not living the way I ought to live. There's something in my heart, something in my life that I know is not right. And I want to get rid of it. I feel so guilty, so unclean. Friend, there's good news for you. The Bible says in John 3:17, that Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but through him the world might be saved. And he said in 1 John 1:9 that if we but confess our sin, he's faithful and just to cleanse us from all sin, forgive us from all unrighteousness. All you have to do is turn back and say, God, I mean it. I'm sorry, and I'm not going to do it anymore. You turn from that sin, and God will forgive you. He'll wash you as clean and as bright as a new-driven snow if you'll turn. Moment we're going to sing. The altar's open if you need to come and pray. Nobody will bother you. Nobody will harass you. If you want somebody to pray with you, you want me to pray with you, come. Take my hand. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, by all means, come and say, Preacher, I want to get it right today. I want to trust Christ today. I want you to understand Christ is preeminent. He's waiting on you. Father, today I pray you'd help us respond according to your will. In Jesus' name.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come.